Hello, I'm Richard Ager. Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. Well, it's a new day with new faces at the State House. Those who were elected to the State House and Senate met on Wednesday to choose their new leaders. And here to discuss the new legislature are Josh Rogers from New Hampshire Public Radio, Kevin Landrigan from the Nashua Telegraph, and James Pindle of WMURPoliticalScoop.com. Welcome, all of you. Well, we'll get to our discussion in just a few moments, but first, here's some of what happened on Organization Day.
So with that, I'd like to ask you all to raise your right hand.
Though many of the decisions and much of the work are done before Organization Day, this is when it becomes official. The newly elected members of the legislature are sworn in and begin earning their $100 a year.
I just want to say that I've never had a more important temporary position in my whole life.
On his first day off the state Supreme Court, former Chief Justice John Broderick served as the Senate's presiding officer. First order of business, electing a new Senate president. And with 19 Republicans outnumbering the five Democrats, it didn't take long to make the selection of Peter Bragdon official.
My friends and colleagues, we face a very difficult financial challenge in the coming months. I do not think that's much of a matter of dispute. Although campaign season provided a very good opportunity to debate issues related to why we find ourselves in this situation, campaign season is over, thankfully. We must now focus our attention and our efforts on how to address this situation. We must work together to identify our challenges and work together to craft solutions.
Bragdon praised outgoing Senate President Sylvia Larson for treating Republicans fairly when they were in the minority and promised to streamline the hearing process.
For the same reason, when I chair Senate committees, I encourage speakers to keep their remarks to 3 minutes or less, and I hope the lobbyists are listening today.
In the House, former Speaker Gene Chandler had already lost his bid to become Speaker and so nominated his party's choice.
I'm very pleased to have been asked to do this because now I get to play a small part in hopefully someone winning for Speaker. So.
Outgoing Speaker Terry Norelli was nominated again by the Democrats, who now hold only a quarter of the House seats.
I want to thank you again, both for the opportunity of having served as the Speaker of the House for these past 4 years, and also for being placed in nomination. I do, however, respectfully decline the nomination, and Madam Chair, I would ask to be recognized for a motion.
Representative Norelli is recognized for a motion.
I would move that nominations for Speaker be closed.
And with that, it became unanimous and official.
The member from Mount Vernon, Representative William Lawrence O'Brien, is the Speaker of the House for the 2011-2012 session.
When Speaker Norelli, when she was making it a unanimous vote for you, she also painted a fairly rosy picture of the condition of the state, balanced budget, best growth in New England. How much do you agree with her assessment as she hands the reins over to you?
Nothing was inaccurate. It just wasn't the complete picture. What was not mentioned is the structural deficit that we face the next budget of between $700 and $800 million. What wasn't mentioned is that budget was balanced by taking, for example, $25 million from the University of New Hampshire raiding the rainy day fund. So nothing inaccurate about it. I respect her view of what has happened over the last few years, but we know we have some problems that have to be solved.
What is the biggest change that you're looking at?
One of the biggest changes is partly a symbolic one and partly a change that represents a new reality. We're going to take up revenues first. House Bill 1 traditionally has been the spending bill. It's now going to be the revenue bill. We're going to concentrate on that and make sure that we know what revenues we should be taking from the businesses and people of New Hampshire and guided by the fact we want jobs to return to New Hampshire. And then we'll look at how we spend the money. So that's going to be perhaps the biggest change.
And Speaker O'Brien also said the budget is priority number 1 through 10, and he hasn't discovered what number 11 is yet, so clearly a real focus early
on. Yeah, I think the other focus for him is going to be what to do about the 1,000 or so bills we're going to end up with, because as your piece points out, we've got a whole lot of new legislators, many of which who have pretty ambitious agendas, and a lot of it doesn't involve the budget.
what you see, obviously a challenge for the House to get its priorities. And he did say that revenue is what they're going to look at first, and then spending.
Yes, and he says that that will, you know, properly set the priorities. I mean, you know, back in the past, you know, the budget was one committee, and that they, you know, would work. You know, and this is the bifurcation of ways and means and finance. You know, we'll see. You're going to have to do both at the same time. I mean, certainly it takes a longer time to set the spending than it does to identify the revenues. And so people, you know, anticipate that they'll be, you know, on parallel tracks. But, you know, his bottom line is, you know, we've got to figure out how much money we have before we can figure out how to spend it. And so we'll see how that works out. I mean, that is the biggest structural change. I mean, there's been talk about, you know, maybe having more committees, maybe meeting fewer times a week. But that's the big thing that they're stressing.
We're also talking about the largest majority of a party in state history in terms of the House. And as Kevin was hinting to earlier, we have all of these bills that are going to be taking place. And roughly half of this Republican caucus are new legislators. And we have really no, they come with a sense of idealism, but we have no sense of where the breakdowns are going to happen. We talk about a tone about fiscal conservatism. I think obviously it's another New Hampshire session. We're going to begin to talk about the budget and where we're going to cut. That's where we begin the conversation. But what happens with we get to some of these other issues, particularly social issues, and there are going to be like little sub-caucuses developing among this group, and who will the leaders be that emerge, and will he be able to sort of tamp down and keep everyone in line? Those are going to be some of the fun subplots to watch.
Well, you know, Kevin, of course, the governor is the first to actually bring out a budget as the process goes forward. Do you see a potential for some conflict early on when he brings out his version of what revenues and spending will be over the next 2 years?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure that's inevitable. But I don't think this leadership, either in the House or the Senate, is going to wait for the governor to make the first move. I think that's what both the new speaker and Senate president are signaling now. While the governor's doing his due diligence with the agencies, trying to figure out how spending can be limited in these tough economic times, the House and Senate budget writers, I think, are going to be working on these parallel tracks that James talks about. This obviously is a pretty good time to, from a process point of view, swap things to start with revenue and then go to spending. I'm not sure whether, even if Democrats were in charge, I think they may well have done more looking at revenue first before you went to spending, because as we've talked about here, and this campaign was all about over the last 10, 11 months, we've got this big looming shortfall. But so much of it has to do with what our assumptions are about revenue and what our assumptions are about the future of this economy.
Well, you know,
and
Senator,
how quickly we're going to recover.
Yeah, because Senator Bragdon was saying in his first speech as president of the Senate that there is really no dispute over the fiscal challenges that, that face the state. But really, I mean, is there consensus on the actual size of the deficit?
Well, I mean, it's always a moving target. And, you know, one has to be careful about, you know, a lot of it depends on, you know, how much of the federal tide will be, you know, heading out, you know, how the economy, I mean, obviously the traditional thing is for, you know, the state to be rescued by budget problems through federal money, and then maybe the economy goes up, and then, you know, the status quo pretty much remains. People aren't anticipating that this time, but, you know, $500 million is sort of, you know, in the middle of what people are talking about. And so, you know, everyone's saying, you know, tighten your belt, make the tough decisions, but we don't really know. And, you know, regardless of what people say now, we are not going to know, you know, until, you know, the end of June, where things land on this. And so, but there's agreement that there's going to be cuts, and certainly the leadership has made quite plain that they're not looking at increased taxes.
Well, as Senator Bragdon said, some programs will be left on the cutting room floor.
And while there may be some debate in terms of how big this budget deficit may be, let there be no debate as to who has the power. And it's the House and the Senate. You know, Kevin made the argument that they were the ones who can be driving this train. They're not going to be waiting for Governor Lynch. Look, Governor Lynch went from one of the number one or number two most popular governors in the country to the second weakest in the country. I mean, he has Republican majorities that can override him. The more interesting, less interesting question is about what does this mean in terms of Republican leadership. The more interesting is what kind of John Lynch are we going to have? Are we going to have a John Lynch walking around with his brand new shiny scissors, going to ribbon cuttings all over the place? Or is he going to be working his veto pen? Maybe he grabs it from John Stephen and tries to make an argument as to whether or not, hey, I'm trying to stop this action from happening, but the Republicans are overriding me. Will he get along or will he fight back? It's not really in his temperament to fight back, but his party needs him to.
Well, you know, much was made of Comity, Junior Organization Day, Terry Norelli in declining the nomination to make the election of William O'Brien unanimous, also Peter Bragdon praising Senate President Sylvia Larson for her treatment of the Republicans when they are a minority. So clearly they're trying to set a tone here. I'm wondering how long you think that might last.
Well, it's easy to be magnanimous after you've humiliated the opposition, you know, as James points out, the way the Republicans have in this election. And I think the Democrats are going to take a little while trying to find their footing, what their role is going to be. Are we going to really fully participate as we have in the past as a minority, an aggressive minority? Or are we going to take the position small Democratic minorities have taken in the past, which is let them go along their merry way, let them make the mistakes and pass the kind of legislation that is not popular among the voters, and the voters will toss many of them out 2 years from now. I think they're still trying to figure out that strategy.
I mean, I would agree, and I was talking with some Republicans yesterday, and they, at least on day one, claim to recognize and claim that they will remain cognizant of the fact that they have a great opportunity. Like, let's not blow it here by, overreaching. But again, with the new population of lawmakers, and everyone can talk all day long about how the budget is, A to Z. The Finance Committee is not made up of 400 people. Other issues are out there, and the budget is also, when the Democrats were in, it was a grim budget. Some of the social issues that they thought were in the state's interests and were passionate about, ended up taking a lot of time, and it's not irrational to believe that that's possible with Republicans, particularly given the constellation of priorities, and we don't really know who a lot of these people are yet. That remains to be seen. And Bill O'Brien, he said, let's leave the inflammatory rhetoric or something to that effect to the editorial page and to the blogs. I mean, we'll see. He certainly never did that when he was a member of the minority. So we'll see how this goes.
Well, and then we see that all the time, don't we? I mean, over the years, you see it in Congress, too, which is the new leadership comes in and tries to pull up the drawbridge, right?
Now that they're in, yes.
Exactly. Let's all be fair and let's not take partisan shots. Well, there'll be all kinds of partisan shots.
And one thing to watch is we begin this budget conversation with John Lynch saying he wants to cut 5%, and we had John Stephens saying 10. Now they had different ways of how they got to that number. But one thing to watch, I think, in the next 3 or 4 months is where is this bar set? Is it at 9%? Is that a fiscal conservative for Republicans? Or is it 8%? Or is it 7%? Or is it anything above what John Lynch wants? Where is this median of rationality? What's rational? What's logical? What makes sense? What's doable? And with such a large majority, it's 19 members in the state Senate, they can begin to set that bar pretty high. And what's reasonable for the voting public? I mean, maybe they just want to cut everything. And is there another side that comes about on that?
Well, in speaking with Speaker O'Brien after Organization Day, I asked him what's the balance between enhancing revenue or cutting spending in order to get to a balanced budget. He said very clearly they're not going to be looking at raising any kind of taxes. So, he said we were very cognizant of protecting the people and the businesses of New Hampshire to try and enhance
job creation.
But again,
will there be a conservative reason? I mean, for example, let's say that Bill O'Brien or Peter Bragdon, and there could be crazy dynamics between the House and the Senate, I think there will be, right. So if one of them sets the bar at 1% more cuts than John Lynch, is that good enough? Well, or are we going to have a conservative result saying, no, we got to go to 15%?
Well, last time around, the Senate expressed support for gambling. So I asked Speaker O'Brien, what about expanded gambling as a possible revenue source? And he said, no, they're not taking that as any kind of possibility for this time around, that he just doesn't consider it to be a viable source. And he sees no reason for the House to change its previous stance. So it looks like he's eliminating that.
I think that's one of the reasons that I do think one of the reasons they're also starting with revenue, other than the political one, because after all, this is a political argument here. Let's start with revenues, as Josh said. We do them both at the same time. And we always have. They've gotten very partisan in the last 4 years, and more partisan than it was in the tax writing committees. And I think that's what Bill O'Brien objected to, and that's certainly a fair criticism. But I think the Republican leadership in both the House and the Senate will not make one mistake that other Republicans who run the legislature have made before, and that is overestimating the economic recovery. And that's why James' point is crystal clear, which is they're going to be extremely fiscally conservative, and they're going to be more conservative about revenue than John Lynch is, whatever he comes up with. And it's going to drive down a number in spending cuts that is significant, and try to adopt a budget that is not only fiscally responsible, but can be added to if the economy recovers over time, as everyone expects it will.
Well, you know, also, you know, just aside from the budget for the moment, there's quite a few members who have been talking about, as you were mentioning earlier, tackling some of those social issues, possibly revisiting some of the issues that have been decided in the last few years. I mean, gay marriage being a major one. A couple of members on Wednesday said that they're very interested in looking at parental notification again.
I think the less fraud answer for a lot of these Republicans who are newly elected and, you know, people who've been around for a while is like, oh, well, definitely parental notification. I mean, which is interesting in that it, you know, failed for years. You know, passed in 2002. I think it was like, you know, it was fewer than 10 votes in the House, one vote in the Senate. The Republicans I talked to uniformly seem to think like that will happen. Same-sex marriage, that's a tougher one in terms of basically, you know, taking away the rights of people who are married. Certainly there's a decent slug of people in the legislature who want that, who want to move back in the Republican majority. But they're also, it's a lot of these more liberty-minded folk that are in. I think it's too early. I certainly haven't talked to enough people to know precisely where these folks fall down the line. And I think there's going to be, on some social issues, they're going to break from what might consider sort of conservative orthodoxies.
And this is where you get the difference between states. I mean, a lot of states, the House Speaker can just take that bill and say, you know what, I don't really want to talk about it right now, and just not talk about it for the next 2 years, then we can run against it. Here, you don't have that power. I mean, this bill will come to the floor.
I think that's why
the Speaker made a pretty smart move tactically in setting up these caucuses that Republicans are going to have, in which they can get in a room in private, they can talk about these issues, and he can be blunt with them about what can and cannot work, particularly in this first year.
Well, we clearly saw the Republican discipline early on, in which, before Organization Day, they decided among themselves who was going to be the next speaker. So you didn't have a situation like a few years back when Doug Scammon was elected with the support of the Democrats and, I think, a minority of Republicans. But, you know, now with
and just to point out one quick thing. I mean, we talk about how this year is just so focused on the budget, and it absolutely will be. But I remind you that gay marriage passed in the budget year also. So, I mean, these things can bubble up.
Yeah, no, you're right, James. And in fact, like Josh said, it's so much of this is going to be sort of sitting around for months, not just waiting for one version of the budget or the other, but waiting for these monthly revenues reports to see whether, oh, by the way, are we really recovering? Is it there yet? Or are we just going to lump along like we have, basically, for the last year, 15 months?
Well, you know, you were talking about some of the differences between the more libertarian-leaning Tea Partiers and those who are more socially conservative. I mean, we do have veto-proof Republican majorities in both chambers, but do you see the potential for some kind of splits that...
Certainly there always are. I mean, the big majorities, like, come with the biggest likelihood of fissures within the caucus. I mean, you look back to 2002 when parental notice did go through. I mean, that just scraped through. There were huge Republican majorities then. You had Craig Benson in the corner office, you know, cheerleading for this bill. And, I mean, times have changed a bit, but it'll be interesting to see. And a lot of the landscape is different. How different? None of us know at this point.
Well, certainly it's also a reminder that how close the vote was before Organization Day between Gene Chandler, who had run again for Speaker, and O'Brien. It was, I think, about 10 votes difference. So clearly there was a divide there among House Republicans.
And that's one of the big questions, whether or not they're all together now. And what I mean, certainly there's a more passion in the House, I think, than we're going to definitely see in the Senate. And the reason why we don't know, because we all these new people, we literally don't know.
You know, one thing, too, about the more social issues, don't forget that Speaker O'Brien was a member of the Conservative House Alliance. I think he was the co-chair, and also, you know, very supportive of, opposing same-sex marriage and some of those other issues. And I wonder how much of a role he will take in moving some of those bills along.
Well, I think he's, I think both Bill O'Brien and Peter Bragdon already seem to have a pretty good sense of what their role is, which is to preside over the body and let the caucus of their party set the agenda and move that forward. And certainly, the difference between the two is also pretty clear. I mean, Bragdon in the state Senate has had a history of doing that, which is to say working with the Democratic governor, John Lynch, on occasion, particularly on some important issues. Bill O'Brien hasn't had a lot of that history. And as James points out, he's had more a combative style in the legislature than Bragdon did, very low-key, soft-spoken. They have different approaches, but I think they see the job the same way right now.
Well, it promises to be an interesting session. Of course, there is other business going on at the State House this week. We have continuing hearings into the potential removal of Banking Commissioner Peter Hildreth. Josh, I know you've been covering this. What's been going on at these hearings?
Well, we're finally getting to Peter Hildreth. He's begun testifying today, but thus far we've had former bank employees. I mean, the question is should he be... should he lose his job over the banking department's failure
FRM
Ponzi scheme? This has been a long story, and the areas of scrutiny have it's been a little bit musical chairs between bank securities, the attorney general's office, securities director Mark Connelly's gone, Kelly Ayotte is senator elect, Peter Hildreth remains, and the governor and council, they're pretty clear they want him gone. We'll see where this goes. I mean, Kevin's been there as well. A lot of this is going
to
hinge on Hildreth's performance, in a couple of hours. But
as we tape, yes.
Yeah, there's a lot of blame to go around.
Yeah, there is. But, as Hildreth's attorney has stated, I mean, he is the last man standing. Then there is this desire to for there to be a public scalp, if you will, for what happened with FRM. You've got real victims losing serious amounts of money and real failures that were systemic throughout state government. And because of what Josh just spoke about and how people left, he's really the only one to punish. And it appears he will be punished.
The way the story's been playing out this week is really he is standing alone, not just on this issue, but also in terms of the general context of how people are paying attention to it. I mean, had these hearings happened before Election Day, we would have had a lot more emphasis on Governor Lynch, a lot more emphasis on Kelly Ayotte during the testimony. The fact that it's 3 weeks or so after, or I guess a month after this election and heading into the holiday season, I'm not sure there's a great statewide interest into the story, and it's just really about him, about Concord, and it really hasn't had a broader political implications yet.
I should also mention this: just this past week, we had the Executive Council hearings into the nomination of Linda Delanis, who would be the first female Chief Justice of the state Supreme Court. She's blazed a trail along the way at various levels of the court system. You see this one going right through, Josh?
Oh, certainly. Mm-hmm. I mean, she's been a judge for 30 years now, and a safe pick and a pick that people in the legal community seem to think is a good one, and that they believe that some of the things she's done. I mean, a lot of the big challenges are going to be administrative. It's not simply like, oh, is she a competent jurist? Like the court, like every other branch of government, perhaps more so, is going to face fiscal pressures and. People believe that her experience up and down will help her administer the court. But also with this new legislature, it's an interesting time to become Chief Justice when they have a grievance caucus that has petitions out there to remove marital masters already, and we haven't even got to the session.
And of course, she follows John Broderick, who was somewhat combative in his final year in fighting for the budget of the court system.
Yeah, and haven't we seen that with most chief justices? They seem to have like a shelf life, you know, that there's a honeymoon period after they take over, and then there's a couple of years of a shakedown cruise where you determine what they're really like, and then the last year or two it gets combative. We tried to impeach the previous one before John Broderick, and like you said, Broderick became pretty feisty, and the legislature really pushed back. Justice Delanus has a pretty good relationship with the legislature at the middle management level, and that's kind of her style. It'll be interesting to see. She's different than John Broderick is. She's more a manager than a speaker, and pretty well liked for that.
She's a pragmatist,
right?
So we'll see how long that perception.
We got about 20 seconds left. I do want to mention the fact that Bill Gardner has been reelected for his 20th term as Secretary of State, the great protector of the primary. James, 10 seconds. What's going on in the primary? Are we good?
Well, it's amazing. We only have 14 months to go, basically, until the next New Hampshire primary, and we're just beginning to see some of these candidates trickle in. It's always earlier and earlier and earlier, except for this year. It's been later and later and later.
All right, and that is the final word on it. Thank you very much for joining us. And we'll see you next time. I'm Richard Ager for New Hampshire Outlook.